Good evening, everyone, and welcome to WICR. John Stanko here with Kevin Barnett for another episode of the BS Report. It is 8 o'clock on the dot, and unfortunately today we are able to have the show because there is no March Madness happening on the men's side. Yeah. The men's side is off until Thursday, but we did need a couple days to breathe.
Spring break coming up clutch.
Yes, spring break did come
coming
up clutch.
Clutch in that department.
But we did need a couple days to breathe because the first two opening rounds of March Madness are, in my opinion, the best I have ever seen since I started watching it when I was, 10 years old?
You know, when we watched, what was it, the first night? It was, three, four overtime games?
Four overtime games in the first day.
I mean, there was this running joke going around saying Buffalo Wild Wings was the real winner because of all the advertisements they had because of overtime. So, no, but I remember the first game. I mean, on the way, because I was flying back from the Dominican Republic, actually.
Oh, casual. Going to the Dominican Republic.
Yeah, casual. I was flying back. I caught some games, caught the end of the Harvard-Cincinnati game. I missed, apparently, what a lot of people said was the game of the tournament, Dayton and Ohio State.
It was a good game. We wouldn't call it the game of the tournament. But it was a very good game.
Yeah, I watched the end. I got the end of Harvard-Cincinnati. Another good ending. Picked Harvard in that game.
I did too.
Tommy Amaker, he's going to get a job soon.
I think he's going to stay there, actually. Yeah. I think he likes his system. I think job security at Harvard now is set for as long as he needs. I think job security is big.
And Harvard doesn't struggle paying either.
So. Exactly. So I think he's going to stay.
I've heard Boston College might be interested, though, even though Calhoun apparently wants the coach. But
They don't want him. That's what I've heard.
They need, because if you're going to hire Jim Calhoun, you're going to need to make sure Calhoun has a guy like Kevin Ollie.
Exactly.
And that's no guarantee with that. Ollie, great coach for UConn.
Mm-hmm.
Very good handpicked successor. So, one of my favorite games was, even though I had Arizona State, Texas, Arizona State was a great game.
Oh, it was a great game.
Wichita, Kentucky, another good game. I had Wichita in the national championship, though. So.
Ooh.
I mean, with how good they played last year in the tournament, it was too hard for me not to pick them to go far.
Oh, listen, we'll get into our tournament. You know what? Let's start. We're going to recap the NCAA tournament. That's what we're going to open up this show on. We're going to go region by region. We're going to start in the South. We're going to recap the first round, then move to the Sweet 16, who we see moving forward, moving on to the Final Four, the Elite Eight, so on. So starting in the South region, you had the opening round winners were Florida over Albany, Pittsburgh demolishing Colorado.
All that.
Stephen F. Austin with, in my opinion, the second best game of the tournament.
That was a great game. I mean, I had VCU in that game. I had VCU in the Sweet 16. I agree with you. That definitely the second best game of the
second
tournament.
Second best game of the tournament.
I mean,
in my
I was so mad, though, because I had VCU. And I was doing so well on ESPN at this point. I was 99.7. And then VCU lost on the 4-point play.
It was unbelievable. Yeah. I mean, I got texts from all my friends going, why do you foul on that? Why do you foul? Just... he closed out, and then the guy made a really tough shot. I mean, you want instincts to kick in, but instincts are for them to challenge every shot. That's the way VCU plays, and that's the way he played that last bucket there for Stephen F. Austin in regulation. A great game. So Stephen F. Austin was the darling in that one, coming out with beating VCU, who was the darling a couple years ago. You had UCLA taking care of business against Tulsa. You mentioned the other great game in the South region in the round of 64, Ohio State losing to Dayton in the in-state rivalry. Did you see Dayton's newspapers after?
Why I was happy, A, because I don't like Ohio State. I had them winning, but A, I don't like Ohio State, but B, they've been ducking Dayton for years.
They have been
Dayton. The same state, they've been ducking them for years. And they finally got this game, and they showed them, hey, you screwed up not playing, trying to play us.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was, you know how like it's always like the Ohio State? That's the way they say it. The Dayton newspaper the next day read, the University of Dayton.
There we go.
The in bold and in big print, just to rub it in everyone's face. But that was a great win for the Flyers. Another great game. That was the first game of the tournament. That's how it started out.
Yes.
Phenomenal start. Then finally, you had Syracuse beating Western Michigan in the round 64. New Mexico losing to Stanford.
I had Stanford in that
A little
game.
Bit of a Cinderella. I did not have Stanford, but Stanford, a little bit of a Cinderella because they went on to beat Kansas in the round of 32. Kansas beat Eastern Kentucky in the first round.
I can't say I'm surprised by that, honestly, with Stanford beating Kansas, because, one, if you haven't realized, except for, like, the two great runs that Bill Self has had to the national championship, he's been a very subpar tournament coach.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, they didn't have Joel Embiid, who many people say will be the top pick in this year's draft.
That's the thing. I trusted Kansas enough to get to the Sweet 16 without Joel Embiid.
Where maybe they couldn't get Embiid back.
And then they can get Embiid. I can't go to the Elite Eight. That's what I
had them going to the Sweet 16 losing to Syracuse. Of course, Dayton beat Syracuse, went on to beat Syracuse.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that with how well Andrew Wiggins was playing, he could have carried them himself.
Well, where was he against Stanford?
He was nowhere to be found against Stanford.
4 points. He only took 6 shots. I don't know how a player of his caliber only takes 6 shots.
I mean, he was finally living up to all the hype that, like, in the preseason.
He had the 41-point game at the end of the regular season against West Virginia.
And then
Virginia.
He killed in the Big 12 tournament.
He did well in the Big 12 tournament, but he didn't have a great game in the opening round against Eastern Kentucky, where Kansas did have to fight to get the win. They won by 11. But it was
A lot of these lower seeds, yes, have been. Like, I mean, even Florida was tied at one point with UAlbany.
I was a little nervous. Oh, I was very nervous.
A lot of these teams, like Weber State gave Arizona a great game. Mm-hmm. I think it's just the nature. Coastal Carolina, Virginia.
Yeah, that was
Virginia.
A very good
Virginia was starting to get really hyped up because they thought they were going to lose it maybe at one point.
It wasn't Carolina winning at halftime. Am I remembering that correctly?
They may have been. Yeah.
I think they're winning
at
halftime.
State had a 10-point lead at Arizona at one point.
Yeah. There you go. But for the round of 64 in the South region, I think the best game in the region was, in my opinion, Stephen F. Austin beating VCU on that remarkable 4-point play and then just carrying the momentum into overtime. The Lumberjacks beat Coach Shaka Smart. That, in my mind, I was screaming on my computer watching it. It was an unbelievable ending.
We were watching. It was like Shaka. I mean, the VCU, you said they were the darlings of the tournament a couple of years ago. Now it's like they're just
exactly.
I wouldn't say a powerhouse, but like they're just
expected to win.
They're expected to be there.
Now the rumor is Shaka Smart might be leaving VCU. It happens every year.
Every single
but
year.
But the Marquette job opened up because Buzz Williams went to Virginia Tech. So people are saying that Shaka Smart might be lured by Marquette.
Well, what people don't know is I think Marquette is a better basketball job than Virginia Tech. Why do these coaches leave, though?
I mean, obviously money is...
It's money is the main thing. And Shaka Smart makes $1.4 million a year to school like
VCU. It's true.
They're investing a lot in him. So I think until maybe he possibly gets a Duke job, a job like Duke when Coach K retires... I mean, he'd be right. If I were Duke, I'd take a hard look at him when Coach K does retire.
Mm-hmm.
But I think he's waiting for a really, really prestigious job.
I mean, the only thing I will argue your Marquette point with, saying better than Virginia Tech, is Virginia Tech is in the ACC. ACC is a better basketball conference. It's the best basketball conference in the country.
And
Buzz Williams wanted the chance to compete against the best teams and improve himself, I think, against competition.
I think he's much better than the Virginia Tech job, Buzz Williams. He's one of my favorite coaches. I think he could have gotten a better job than that.
I think if he can build that program around, I think it's a pretty good job.
I thought that he could have been like he could have gotten like a really prestigious job. Like I was surprised someone like UCLA didn't hire him last year.
But, I mean,
Steve Alford's doing a good job this year at UCLA. So.
Mm-hmm.
Even though he did terrible for New Mexico in the tournament.
That's true. New Mexico did lose to Stanford. So in the round of 32 in the South region, Stanford beat Kansas. As we mentioned, you move on to the Sweet 16. Andrew Wiggins invisible in the game.
Agreed.
No impact whatsoever. You had Dayton, a great game against Syracuse, a phenomenal game.
Syracuse just went from being a building off of last year's Final Four run to just...
Weren't they 25-0, 26-0? I think
they were 25-0.
25-0.
They lost to Boston College.
And that's right.
That's where it all started. And then between the Boeheim's eruption at Duke, the early exit in the ACC tournament, it was just a downward spiral after that loss to Boston College.
I had Ohio State beating Dayton and then going to the Sweet 16, upsetting Syracuse. Obviously, Ohio State didn't make it past the round of 64, but I did not believe in Syracuse at all because the way they ended their season.
I mean, I did, honestly, because I thought that they were similar to last year's team. Where a lot of people, like, I got killed for picking Syracuse to go so far last year.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so pumped every single game they won. They beat Indiana last year. They beat Marquette, Buzz Williams' Marquette in the Elite Eight. I was pumped when they made it that far. And they should have beaten Michigan, I thought, in the Final Four game. But I had them in the national championship, so.
there you go. And then also you had Stephen F. Austin ending their run with a loss to UCLA in the round of 32 in the South
region.
That's
going to be a good one, UCLA and Florida.
UCLA-Florida, they took care of business, especially late against Pittsburgh. But that UCLA-Florida matchup, UCLA is playing really good basketball.
I just don't think they're as good as Florida, though.
That's the thing, though.
Florida is showing that experienced seniors, actually, in college do matter compared to really talented freshmen like Kansas has.
Yeah, or we're going to get to another team in Kentucky that starts all freshmen, and look what they're doing.
Yes.
So now we got the Sweet 16 in the South region. We got Florida versus UCLA, Dayton versus Stanford. Kevin, what are your picks to go to the Elite Eight in the South region?
I think it's Florida and Stanford.
Okay.
I'm going with Florida and Stanford. I think Stanford, Dayton, I think, is beating better teams than Stanford has right now. But from what I saw, I think we do have to give some credit to Stanford for making Wiggins disappear, honestly.
I think you can give some credit. I'm not willing to give more than half the credit, though. I think Wiggins wasn't aggressive enough when he had the ball.
I think that they had a better regular season, Stanford, where Dayton kind of snuck in. I mean, they got past the first four with a nice... With they got bad. I mean,
Only reason they didn't play in the first work is because it's held in Dayton, and they can't play in their home arena in the opening four games. So you can't do that.
Kind of snuck in there.
Exactly.
But I just feel right there. Stanford just is kind of a better basketball team.
Okay.
I think that's just my gut feeling.
I mean, I have.
And they had some miracle. Sorry to cut you off.
No,
they had some
problem.
Miracle like wins, but like late endings. You know, with Tyler Ennis missing the shot, and then Aaron Kraft missing. I don't think that'll happen this time around.
Well, I had Florida winning it all at the start of this tournament. I still believe in them. I think they're going to beat UCLA.
I'm right there with you.
I am riding with the Flyers, though.
Ooh.
I am going with the Cinderella. Going to make it to the Elite Eight. I think that they beat better teams in Ohio State and Syracuse, two very good defensive teams, better defensive teams than Stanford as a whole. Stanford, the end of that game against Kansas really scared me because when Kansas put on pressure, Stanford could not get the ball up the court. They didn't have a true point guard that could get them across the timeline and have them set up an offense. I think that could be big problems for them against Dayton. So I'd say I'm going to ride the Flyers going to the Elite Eight, the 11 seed. Reaching the Elite Eight.
Neither of them are beating Florida, though, I don't think.
No.
Or even UCLA if they get to UCLA.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. The winner of the Florida-UCLA game is going to the Final Four in my mind. But I'm going with the Dayton Flyers to the Elite Eight.
I agree. I mean, I respectfully disagree in that there.
All right, that's fair. Now moving on down below the South region, we will head to the East region.
Madison Square Garden.
Yes, Madison Square Garden is the host of these Sweet 16 games. In the round of 64, to begin you off, Virginia did beat Coastal Carolina.
It was a tight game.
It was a tight one throughout, but Virginia pulled it out. Memphis beat George Washington in the 8-9 matchup. Harvard upset Cincinnati. They were the sexy upset pick.
Yes.
We both picked them.
Tommy Amaker has done wonders with that program.
Mm-hmm.
They were 14 seed last year and defeated New Mexico in the first round.
And they're a 12 seed this year. They beat Cincinnati by a score of 61-57. We had Michigan State beating Delaware in the opening round. Payne having the game of his life,
Adrian Payne, 41 points.
I believe that's a career high for him.
He didn't do
obviously.
As well against Harvard in the next game, though.
No, but we'll get to that round of 32 game. UNC beat Providence in a great game. Not many people saw it, but the battle between Marcus Page and Bryce Cotton of the Providence Friars was one of the best one-on-one matchups of this tournament.
I missed it.
Oh, man.
I missed it.
Bryce Cotton, Providence lost the game, but Bryce Cotton won fans, and he won the crowd.
I can't wait to talk about the North Carolina-Iowa State game.
Oh, yes.
And then we get to that, yes.
Iowa State defeated North Carolina Central in the round of 64. Connecticut beat St. Joe's. They had to come from behind, but they were able to do it.
They won in overtime. They dominated the overtime
They
period.
Did. Villanova beat Milwaukee easily in the round of 64. Well, then in the round of 32, Connecticut squared off against Villanova, and I'm going to toot my own horn here. I had the Huskies beating the Wildcats and getting to the Sweet 16.
Oh, you're tooting your own horn.
I am tooting my own horn.
I as well had UConn beating the Wildcats.
Some great minds think alike.
Yes.
Connecticut advances to the Sweet 16 with a 77-65 win over Villanova. Shabazz Napier is having a phenomenal tournament for UConn. Kemba Walker-esque.
I think if the tournament were to end today, I would actually give the most outstanding player to Shabazz Napier.
You really would.
Yeah. I think he's even the reason. I mean, look, I love Kevin Ollie, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
He's a great coach, but Napier is like, since his freshman year, he's been a great player for that program.
You got to remember, Napier was on the team that Kemba Walker had the run on with Jeremy Lamb, I believe, as well, that
right.
Connecticut team that made the run
and
in the tournament.
Yeah, but that was Alex Oriaki.
Yeah.
Very good. That was a very good
That's
team.
That's why, that Connecticut team, they surprised everyone with their run. I don't see the Huskies making a deep run this year.
I see them beating Iowa State.
You see them beating
I think North Carolina. Right. I think North Carolina should have had a chance to win that game. Sorry,
right,
but yeah.
Right.
Let's go
ahead. You know what? Iowa State defeated UNC in the round of 32. You want to talk about that game? DeAndre Kane of the Cyclones was an unstoppable force that UNC could not. They couldn't defend him. They had nobody who could match up on him. So Iowa State was able to defeat UNC in another great and close one, 85-83.
I'm sorry, what is the name of the Iowa State player again that's out? I always draw a blank.
Niang.
This is from what I heard, that's a big loss. I don't know. I don't really follow Iowa State very often.
Mm-hmm.
So I know Fred Hoiberg has done really well with the program, former sharpshooter in the NBA. But when I watched that game, that was a great play by Kane to get the go-ahead basket.
Mm-hmm.
But Roy Williams was calling timeout long before. Like, yes, the clock did not start. But he was calling timeout even before.
No, he was not. He was calling timeout when there was 0.4 seconds left, and the clock would have expired if the clock started on time.
The ref ran right by him. He was calling
timeout
right away.
It's when the referee sees it. It's when the referee blows his whistle.
He was getting in the ref's face. He ran right by it.
It The ruling they had on the court at the end of that game was, I think, the correct one. I think Roy Williams, if he wanted to call a timeout, should have done it right off the inbound.
Which he did.
He did not do it when he made the free throw. When he made the free throw, he did not call the timeout.
I think they should have had a chance, though, at least.
I respectfully disagree with you on that one. I think that Roy Williams...
Or maybe you're just a Duke fan who disagrees.
I'm not impartial to Duke or UNC. I'm impartial to good basketball.
I'm just messing with you. I respect that story you said when you played at the Duke, when you got to go on Cameron Indoor.
God, it was unbelievable. Greatest experience in my life. But yeah, Iowa State, they move on to the round to the Sweet 16 with an 85-83 win over UNC, but again, Niang out for Iowa State. We'll get into the Sweet 16 match between Connecticut and Iowa State. But first round of 32, Harvard matched up against Michigan State, and in the end, Michigan State proved to be too big for Harvard. The Crimson fall to the Spartans, and the Spartans, the sexy Final Four pick, moves on, and they're going to play Virginia, who absolutely dismantled Memphis. It was not even a contest.
Whatever scare people had about Virginia in the opening round game definitely went away.
Oh, yeah.
Because Memphis is a talented basketball team, so...
Mm-hmm. So let's get to the Sweet 16's matchup. We'll start with the number 3 seed Iowa State playing the 7 seed Connecticut Huskies. You said you have the Huskies moving on.
Yeah, Shabazz Napier is just carrying this team right now. I love the direction going in. I like the coaching matchup too. Fred Hoiberg and Kevin Ollie, mm-hmm. former NBA players. They're young guys, so they relate to the players really well. I know more about Connecticut than I do Iowa State. I've seen Connecticut play enough. They took it to Villanova, who was basically like the fifth number one seed. If you're going like so, Villanova's having a fantastic season.
Overranked in my mind though, Villanova.
Yeah, I could see that. Yeah, I mean they had an early exit from the Big East tournament, but. Connecticut though they took it to Villanova. The St. Joseph's team was a little underseeded. Mm-hmm. I thought it could have been an 8 seed, even a 7 seed where UConn is. I thought they were a little underseeded St. Joe's with the great coach Phil Martelli.
Mm-hmm.
So they really showed like how athletic and good shape they are in that overtime. Because while St. Joe's, they wore St. Joe's down, they won that. I've been more impressed. I don't think Iowa State should be there right now because I think North Carolina could have had a chance to pull it out. You never know. But
well, I do agree with you. I think Connecticut's going to beat Iowa State only because I think the loss in Niang is going to catch up to the Cyclones. I think when you're losing your star center, your star big man who could stretch the floor and pass the ball efficiently, I think that's a huge loss. I think you can survive one game, but again, Shabazz Napier is carrying Connecticut. I'm incredibly excited for a DeAndre Kane versus Shabazz Napier.
That's going to be
that one-on-one matchup between the two superstars. I think it's going to be fantastic basketball to watch.
It's also going to be fun because like this is someone like a program like Iowa State, UConn team always there, no problem. Iowa State, you know, this is their one really good team in however many years. So that's like I think they're going to come in more motivated though for sure.
We'll see what happens. I can see that one going either way, but I'm gonna ride the hot and healthy team of Connecticut.
And also keep in mind where the game is too.
It is in Madison Square Garden,
so it's gonna be very pro UConn.
The Huskies will have fans.
They have a nice fan base in the New York area. So,
and the other Sweet 16 matchup is a tricky one. The 1 seed Virginia Cavaliers going against the 4 seed Michigan State Spartans. Kevin, who do you got in this one?
Oh, this is the game. I mean, between this and Kentucky and Louisville, I'm gonna have a really problem debating, honestly, who I think is gonna win. I want to say Virginia, but I had Michigan State in the Final Four, so I'm gonna keep it. Adrian Payne, I think is just a fantastic player. I mean, the 41 points, he didn't do as well against Harvard. Harvard really game planned for him, but Tom Izzo is just one of the best in the business.
Mm-hmm.
I think in this game that Michigan State has been there before. They know what it's like. When it comes to stuff like this, I mean, yeah, they can have a bad night and everything, but even some of Izzo's teams that he made the Final Four with weren't even his greatest teams. His greatest teams don't even go as far as some of his Final Four teams. So I think that they're just too experienced, and I think they're playing better basketball than Virginia right now.
I agree with you. I think that the Spartans have to get point guard Keith Appling going, though. He only has 6 points thus far this tournament.
Yeah,
I think
Appling's been a good player throughout his career at Michigan State.
I think he needs to play well. I think that Michigan State has the best combination of experience and talent left in the tournament in terms of like upperclassmen who've been there before and pure talent. So I think that Michigan State, I agree with you. I think they'll eke out Virginia. But can I see the Cavaliers winning and shutting them down? Yes, I can.
I can too.
But again, I'm with you. I picked Michigan State in the beginning to make the Final Four. You got to stick to your gut. And that's why I'm going to go with the Michigan State Spartans.
The one thing that I'll just say about this too is Oh, wow. I'm just losing my point, actually. Michigan State got shafted as a 4 seed. They should have been a 2 or 3. I mean, after winning the Big Ten tournament, shafted as a 4 seed.
I mean, I can agree with you. I mean, you could say the same about Louisville, though. I mean, what does it matter when the seeds come out? I mean, you're a good team. You're going to go up against a good opponent.
Tell that to Wichita State.
This is true.
Tell that to Wichita State. This they got true. A bad matchup in Kentucky when they had to play them.
Mm-hmm.
So.
All right, we'll take a short break here on WICR. This is the BS Report. John Singer here with Kevin Barnett. Take a short break, come back with the other two regions on the right side of the bracket, and then by the end of the show, we will touch a little bit on your darling NFL free agency.
D-R-C.
We'll be right back here on WICR.